From September 29th through October 3rd in 1903, residents of Van Meter, Iowa were living in fear. Several respected and prominent men of the town reported seeing a large half-human, half-animal with enormous bat-like wings. The creature also made a raspy, metallic sound, and it was immune to gunfire. It had a horn on its head, and at the tip, there was a blinding and disorienting white light. And it's somewhat similar to the Blue Ridge Mountain Monster, the Snallygaster, as well as the Jersey Devil and the Mothman. The Snallygaster was described as having a razor-like beak, very sharp claws, and a single eye in the middle of its forehead, and it also made a screeching sound like a locomotive whistle. The Mothman didn't make its appearance until 63 years later, and the Jersey Devil was usually seen in the Northeast. This cryptid became known as the Van Meter Visitor or the Van Meter Monster, and based on witness testimony and for 5 terrifying nights, something very strange took place there. The town's population hasn't changed much since 1903. It was around 1,000 then, and it's less than 2,000 today. The first sighting took place downtown in the city's business district around 1 o'clock in the morning, and U.G. Griffith, a businessman, was returning home, and he was the first to see the Van Meter Visitor. He assumed that the bright light that he saw on the top of a building was from the lantern of a burglar, but the light disappeared and it reappeared on top of another building. No burglar could move like that. When he got closer, it jumped to a rooftop across the street, and then it disappeared, and he said that it was about 9 feet tall. The very next night, around the same time, Dr. Alcott, the town doctor, was asleep in a room above his office when he was awakened by a bright light shining into his window. He ran outside with his gun and quickly learned that the source of the light was from a tall humanoid with bat-like wings and that the blinding light came from a horn in its forehead. And at close range, he fired 5 times at the creature, but he realized that his weapon wasn't having any effect whatsoever. So because of that, he runs back inside and he locks the doors and the windows, and that's where he stays until the next morning. The next night, banker Clarence Peter Dunn met the visitor, and he heard about what happened the night before, so he felt that he should watch over the bank with his shotgun nearby. He had to make sure that he protected the town's funds, or the town could go bankrupt. Around 1 o'clock in the morning, he heard a strange sound outside, and he was suddenly blinded by a bright beam of light that came in through his window. The light went off and then it came back on. As if it was scanning the room, it would look from side to side. And Peter Dunn couldn't make out much, but he could tell that something very large was behind that light. So he fired his shotgun right through the bank's front window, and just like before, there was no effect on the creature. The next morning, he noticed a set of large 3-toed footprints outside of the bank, and he claimed to have made plaster casts of them, but they've never been found. O.V. White was a marksman, and he was the owner of a local hardware store, and he was jolted awake by a metallic rasping sound outside of his second floor room above his hardware store. He grabbed his gun and moved towards the window, and outside he saw the creature perched on a telephone pole, and he attempted to shoot it. And instead of using its blinding light or making a noise, it released a horrible smell in White's direction, and it made him lose consciousness. The shots woke up White's neighbor, Sidney Gregg, who had been sleeping in his store nearby, and he ran outside to see what was going on, and then he watched in disbelief as the creature climbed down the pole like a parrot using its beak. The light moved around just like it had before in a scanning motion, and when it reached the ground, it was estimated to be about 8 to 9 feet tall, and it hopped like a kangaroo, and it paused for a few seconds before flying off towards the old abandoned coal mine close by. Even someone from the local high school saw it, and they referred to it as an antediluvian creature, which means before the Great Flood. It could also mean something ancient. In Christianity and Judaism, the antediluvian period begins with the fall of the first man and woman, and it's a time of great wickedness. And the antediluvian period ended when God sent the flood to wipe out all life, except for Noah, his family, and the animals on the ark. The mine was 260 feet deep, and it was large enough to have stables underground for mules. A posse was formed to ambush the creature at the mine, since they saw it fly in that direction. Once they reached the mine, they found that the Van Meter visitor wasn't alone. With it was a smaller version of the creature, and it was about 4 feet tall. And according to an article in the Des Moines Daily News on October 3rd in 1903, the following night, strange sounds were heard coming from the abandoned coal mine at the edge of town, and it was described as though Satan and a regiment of imps were coming forth for battle. They tried shooting at it again, but just like the days before, it wasn't affected by the weapons of this earth. And once again, it gave off a terrible odor before crawling back down into the mine. So, unsure of what to do next or how to handle the seemingly immortal creatures, they decided to brick up the mine to ensure that the creatures never saw the light of day again. And since then, the creature or creatures has seldom been seen. Investigator Kevin Lee Nelson, Chad Lewis, and Noah Voss wrote an amazing book on this subject, and it's even been mentioned on Coast to Coast AM, the paranormal radio show. The book mentions that the creature may have been from another dimension. Others believe that it's from another planet or a parallel universe. And cryptozoologists recognize the similarities between the visitor and the Thunderbird, which is a pterosaur-like creature that's still seen throughout the western United States. The Iowa tribe that once lived around Van Meter talked about humanoid Thunderbirds that would shoot lightning from their eyes. Maybe the creatures lived underground. The headlight would be useful in that situation, and it could help them see underground. Others have compared the visitor to the Mothman in West Virginia or the Cornish owl in England. Bullets were said to bounce off of the creature with a metallic clang, which is common among otherworldly visitors. The authors also think that it could possibly be an ultra-terrestrial, which are beings from beyond the realm of human experience, whether they be from a parallel universe, an alternate dimension, or another plane of reality that intersects with our own. This theory is used to explain other strange phenomena that often accompany UFO sightings, like time discrepancies, mysterious flying creatures, poltergeist activity, and mysterious men in black. Skeptics think that it was just a case of mass hysteria that local newspapers helped create. Belief systems can influence what we think these creatures are. And if you believe in God, you may think that these creatures are demons. You may think that they're evil. The author that I mentioned, Chad Lewis, said that the town had mostly forgotten about the visitor. He said that a few people knew about it, but most weren't familiar with it. They were aware that strange stories were associated with the area, but they didn't know a lot of the details. And years ago, teenagers would hang out where the brick and tile factory used to be, which is beside the entrance to the mine, and they'd see shadowy figures there. There were sightings of bat-like creatures reported in the 80s and even as recent as the 2000s, and this was by a guy that saw it on the road near the cemetery. Just a few years ago, a man in Colfax, which is less than 50 miles from Van Meter, said that he saw a large bat that was about 8 feet long out in a field. To commemorate the sightings, there is a Van Meter Visitor Festival that takes place annually in the fall around the anniversary of the events. The mine has been sealed for over a century, and there isn't much left except for the crumbling remains of the brick and tile factory next to the mine. And unfortunately, there is almost no visible trace of the mine today, and all that remains is a bowl-shaped depression in the ground.